رب العالمين وصلى الله وسلم على محمد وآله وصحبه وسلم. إن شاء الله تعالى we're going to continue with our fiqh class from the book of Sheikh Al-Allama Salih bin Fawzan Al-Fawzan حفظه الله. And I want this class to be more interactive. So inshallah we'll read. At the same time, we will ask questions, inshallah, to test your knowledge and see if you have learned from the previous classes. So this chapter, the Shaykh, he speaks about the manner of the prayer. The manner of the prayer. The prayer, the way the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam prayed. And it is not hidden from you that the prayer was prescribed upon the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and his ummah, his followers, us. Not on this earth, but in the heaven. That shows you the superiority of the prayer. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said in the hadith that the first affair that the servant will be questioned about is his prayer. If it is good, the rest of his deed will be good. If it is bad, the rest of his deed will be bad. So the prayer is extremely, extremely, extremely important. So that's why we have to learn it. The Shaykh, he said, here is the prophetic way of performing the prayer. Whenever the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam stood for prayer, he faced the Qibla. So why would he face the Qibla? Anybody can answer a question? Why would he face the Qibla? Why would the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam face the Qibla? Why? Yes, go ahead.
Is that because that's what he was asked to do?
Yeah, he was commanded to do. Commanded to do. Because Allah commanded him in the Quran to face the Qibla. To face the Qibla here means Masjid al-Haram. Masjid al-Haram. Because the Muslims, before that, they used to face al-Masjid al-Aqsa. The Masjid al-Aqsa in Jerusalem for about 6 months. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala abrogated that. Abrogated that ruling of facing al-Masjid al-Aqsa. It was abrogated. Wa'alaikum salam. It was abrogated. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commanded the Prophet and the believers to face al-Masjid al-Haram. Wait. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, in Surah Al-Baqarah, قَدْ نَرَى تَقَلُّبَ وَجْهِكَ فِي السَّمَاءِ فَلَنُوَلِّيَنَّكَ قِبْلَةً تَرْضَاهَا فَوَلِّ وَجْهَكَ شَطْرَ الْمَسْجِدِ الْحَرَامِ وَحَيْتُمَا كُنْتُمْ فَوَلُّوا وُجُوهَكُمْ شَطْرَهُ. The Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he was waiting for the revelation. So Allah said about him, قَدْ نَرَى تَقَلُّبَ وَجِيكَ فِي السَّمَاءِ. We see you turning your face towards the heaven, waiting for the revelation. فَلَنُوَلِّيَنَّكَ قِبْلَةً تَرْضَاهَا. We will direct you in a direction that you will be pleased with. Meaning Masjid al-Haram. And then after that, he said, فَوَلِّ وَجْهَكَ شَطْرَ الْمَسْجِدِ الْحَرَامِ. Face or turn yourself towards Masjid al-Haram. This is a command. And then he said after that, وَحَيْتُمَا كُنْتُمْ. And wherever you might be, whether you are in America, you are in Asia, you are wherever you might be. So you face Al-Masjid al-Haram, Al-Masjid al-Haram, and facing the Qibla is one of the conditions of the Salat. The Salat will not be valid without facing the Qibla. For example, if someone prayed this way, is this the Qibla or is it the direction, the opposite of the Qibla? The opposite of the Qibla. So now, if someone prayed this way, their salat will not be valid. will not be valid. It has to be this way. This is the Qibla. طيب. Adam, you want to say something?
The hadith would be that when they were praying, the Prophet was facing Jerusalem, and then he started facing, he turned and faced the...
Because of the revelation. They were praying. And they were commanded while they're praying to face Masjid al-Haram. So he, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he faced the Qibla, raised his hand, making the palms face the Qibla. So raising the hands up to the earlobes or up to the shoulders, is it from the pillars of the Salat? The obligatory act of the Salat or the Sunan of the Salat? Can anybody answer this? Okay, I'm going to repeat the question again. Raising the hands, both hands, either to the earlobes, right? Or to the shoulder. Is it from the pillars of the Salat, the pillars, or the obligatory act, or the sunan of the Salat? You want to answer?
Obligatory act.
Anyone else? Sunan. Anybody?
I'm guessing.
Guessing. Okay.
It's because it's obligatory.
Obligatory, the correct. Obligatory, the correct answer is sunan, from the sunan. Raising your hand up to your earlobes or up to your shoulders is from the sunan of the salat. What does sunan mean? What does anybody knows what sunan mean? Sunan of the salat. What does it mean? Yes.
Which you can copy in order to gain barakah and rewards while you're praying.
Yes.
But it's not obligated upon you.
So they are what? If they are not obligatory, they are what?
Sunnah.
They are? There is a word.
It's
highly
recommended.
Highly recommended. We are on the same page now? Okay, now I'm going to repeat. Raising the hand up to the shoulders or up to your earlobes is from the sunan. From the sunan mean the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he did. Okay? He did from his sunnah. Okay? From his sunnah. His practical sunnah. Okay? His practical sunnah. Because the sunan are two types. You have the sunan that are verbal statements. And we're going to come to that, inshallah. And you have the sunan that are physical, practical. Like this one, raising the hand. This is physical, right? Okay. Sunnah here, it means highly recommended. Highly recommended. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he did it. And he taught us to do it too. Okay, now question for you. If someone did not raise their hand when they went into ruku' and when they raised from ruku', okay, you're supposed to raise your hand when you go into ruku'. This is sunnah. Okay, when you're supposed to raise your hand when you rise from ruku'. Okay? If someone did not raise their hand, what do you say about their salat? Is salat valid or invalid?
Valid.
Yes, valid. But this person is missing out. You understand? This person is missing out. Because the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said, صلوا كما رأيتموني أصلي. Pray as you have seen me pray. Pray as you have seen me pray. And the companions of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, they narrated to us that he used to raise his hand sallallahu alaihi wasallam, for of course in the beginning of the prayer, and when he will go into ruku', when he will rise from ruku', and also he will raise his hand when he gets up from the third rak'ah. For example, you pray in Salat al-Maghrib. In the first tashahud, when you get up to the third rak'ah, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to raise his hand. Okay, these are the places where the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to raise his hand. And raising the hand, now you know it is from the sunan of the Salat. The Shaykh, he said, saying Allahu Akbar, i.e. Allah is greatest. Okay, the word Allahu Akbar, is it a pillar? I want everybody to answer. I don't want just certain people. Is it the pillar of the Salat? Is it from the obligatory act of the Salat? Or is it from the sunan of the Salat?
Obligatory
act. Allahu Akbar.
Which one?
You know, the Shaykh, you're not paying attention. Okay, I'm gonna repeat again. The Shaykh, he said, whenever the Prophet ﷺ stood for prayer, when he said prayer, does it mean specific prayer or any prayer?
Any prayer.
It's general. Okay, any prayer. He faced the Qibla. This is one of the conditions of the Salat. Raise his hand. This is from the Sunan of the Salat. Right? Making the palms face the Qibla. This is also from the Sunan of the Salat. Saying Allahu Akbar, i.e. Allah is the greatest. So this word, Allahu Akbar, Farid, Brother Farid said it's from the obligatory act. Anyone has any other answer?
First time it's a pillar.
It's a pillar. Okay. Anyone else?
Yeah.
It's a pillar.
In the transition, yeah, that was the obligatory act, yeah.
No, we're talking about, okay, he's saying, after the Qibla, he raises his hand and says, Allahu Akbar. Is this one a pillar or obligatory act?
It's a pillar.
It's a pillar. You change your view now.
It's a pillar.
Now we're on the same page.
You don't say that, you said that it's not valid.
Okay, it is a pillar of the prayer. It is a pillar of the prayer. Tayyip? Okay, now everyone is on the same page. He, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, then holds his left hand with his right one, putting it on his chest, like this. Okay? Or like this. This is sunnah? Or is it obligatory act? Or is it from the pillars? Which one?
Sunnah.
It's sunnah.
Sunnah.
Okay? His sunnah.
But I have something to say about that.
Nah.
Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, there is a hadith, he said,
yeah, it's a sound hadith. The brother is referring to the hadith that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said, we prophet and messengers, we were commanded, means by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala,
to put the right hand over.
Yes, in the salat. But it doesn't necessarily mean it is fard. You understand? It doesn't necessarily mean here it is fard. But it is emphasized sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And we are commanded in the Quran to follow the example of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. The Shaykh, he said, then he, sallallahu alayhi wasallam, says the opening invocation. The opening invocation. What does he mean by opening invocation?
Dua
al-istiftah. Dua al-istiftah. Anyone knows, memorize dua al-istiftah here? Wa la ilaha ghayruka. Subhanaka Allahumma wa bihamdika. Wa tabaraka smuka. وَتَعَالَ جَدُّكَ وَلَا إِلَىٰ غَيْرُكَ. Okay? This is after تكبيرة الإحرام. So you say this دعاء, دعاء لاستفتاح. You open up your prayer with it. Okay? So this دعاء is from the Sunan, right?
Yeah.
Okay. If someone, for example, forgot to say دعاء لاستفتاح, do they have to make up for it or they don't have to make up for it?
No.
They don't have to make up for it. Ahsant. Okay. The Shaykh, he said, he did not observe a certain opening invocation regularly. Means that he did not stick to one particular dua all the time. Because there are different narrations and different ad'iyah, different invocations of the opening of the prayer. So it is permissible to say any of the opening invocation reported to have been said by the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Among these invocation is glory be to you, what Brother Taha mentioned, O Allah, and you be all the praise, and blessed is your name, and exalted is your majesty, and there is no deity worthy of worship but you. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, then after that, he says, I seek refuge with Allah from shaitan, the expelled from the mercy of Allah. In the name of Allah, the entirely merciful, the especially merciful. Okay, now, seeking refuge with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala from the shaitan, is it from the sunan or is it from the obligatory act? From the sunan of the salat. From the sunan of the salat. Now pay attention here. He would say, in the name of Allah, the entirely merciful, Ar-Rahman. The entirely merciful, the especially merciful. Ar-Rahman, Ar-Rahim. Okay, what does this mean? Anybody can explain to us? Yes, tafaddal. Yes.
But he is especially merciful to his believers.
Very good. So, when Allah says Ar-Rahman, it means that this Rahmah, this mercy, encompasses all of his creation, including the non-believers, including the vegetation and everything that exists. But Ar-Rahim is exclusively for the believers. So it's a special mercy. Yes. So there is general mercy and there is specific mercy. General mercy is for all of his creation, and that special mercy is only for the believers. Then he sallallahu alayhi wasallam recite Al-Fatiha, the opening chapter of the Quran. Okay, now tell me about the opening chapter of the Quran. Why is it called the opening chapter of the Quran? Why is it? Because it's the first surah. The greatest surah. Ahsant. The greatest surah in the Quran. So from the names of Surah Al-Fatiha. Can anyone give me some names of Surah Al-Fatiha? Names. Okay, it is Fatiha. This is it right here. Opening chapter. What else? Anybody knows any names of Surah Al-Fatiha? Yes.
The mother of the Quran.
The mother of the Quran. What else? السبع المثاني. السبع المثاني. The often repeated verses. Because we repeat them in the prayer. And every rak'ah you repeat Surah Al-Fatiha. Okay, what else? What are the other names of Surah Al-Fatiha? Yes.
The healer.
Al-Shafi'ah. The healer. Al-Shafi'ah. What else? Al-Ruqya. The incantation. Ruqya. What does Ruqya mean? Anybody knows what Ruqya is? Ruqya is treatment with the Quran. Ruqya is treatment with the Quran. But basically, you can say spiritual treatment and physical treatment as well. Because the Quran is a shifa. As Allah said in the Quran, وَنَنْزِلُ مِنَ الْقُرْآنِ مَا هُوَ شِفَاءٌ لِلْمُؤْمِنِينَ مَا هُوَ شِفَاءٌ وَرَحْمَةٌ لِلْمُؤْمِنِينَ. And we send down from this Quran that which is a shifa, a healing, ورحمة, and a mercy for the believers. And the reason it is called الرُّقْيَة because of an incident that took place in the lifetime of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Can anybody share with us this story?
Okay. Yes.
Nah,
a group of companions were traveling.
Yes.
To seek entertainment from a group of people. However, yes, they refused. So the leader of the tribe,
yes,
was stung by a scorpion.
Yes.
And his tribesmen were trying to find a cure for him. However, they had none. So
yes,
they decided to ask the people who asked for their entertainment to,
yes,
see if they have anything. So, alhamdulillah, they did, but only on the condition of giving a flock of
sheep.
And once they agreed upon it, the Sahaba recited a story of
Sahabi Abu Sa'id al-Khudri.
Abu Sa'id al-Khudri. He recited a story of Fatiha. And as soon as it was done, the man who was stung by the scorpion got up, sprung up, as,
yes,
nothing happened to him.
As nothing happened to him. Ahsant. And then there is something else that is related to the story, because the story has not finished yet. So they went back to Al-Madinah. What happened? I will summarize that. Fadal.
So the Sahaba went back to Medina and they talked to Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. They told him of the story of the incident that happened, and from there, Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam demanded his half of the share.
He told them, no, not half. He told them, give me a share.
Give me a share.
Give me a share. Okay. Now the story is called the story of the scorpion. The story of the scorpion sting. And from this story, the scholars have deduced or extracted one of the names of Surah Al-Fatiha, which is Ar-Ruqya. They call it Ar-Ruqya, the healer. Because in this story, when the companions of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, they went to this village, and you know, the origin that the Arabs, they are very generous. But in this case, this particular tribe, they were not generous. They did not entertain the companions of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And meanwhile, the leader and the chieftain of the tribe got stung by a scorpion. So they tried to cure him, but nothing worked. So they turned to each other and they said, what about the group that came to us to take them in as guests and we rejected them? They may have something for him. So they went to them and the Sahaba, they said, we will not heal him unless you give us a flock of sheep, which they agreed. And then Abu Sa'id al-Khudri radiallahu anhu recited Surah al-Fatiha on him. And he got up like there was nothing wrong with him at all. So then after that, when they went back to Al-Madinah and they told the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam the whole incident, then the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he told the Sahabi, Abu Sa'id al-Khudri, the one who recited al-Fatiha on the man who was stung, he said, وَمَا أَدْرَاكَ أَنَّا رُقِيَةً. How did you know that Fatiha is a ruqya? Idribuli bisam. Give me my share of this flock. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he used to accept the gift, but he does not accept what? Sadaqah. Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he does not accept sadaqah. It's not befitting for the messengers, peace be upon them, to accept sadaqah. But gift, yes. طيب. From also the names of Surah Al-Fatiha, barakallahu feekum, it is called Alhamd, the praise. Why is it called Alhamd? Anybody knows? Because it starts with it. Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen. Praise be to Allah, the Lord of the world. And also, from the names of Al-Fatiha, Al-Ulama, they say the pillar. The pillar, Al-Rukn. Why is it called Al-Rukn, the pillar? Why? Yes. The Salat will not be accepted without it. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "La salata liman lam yaqra bi fatihat al-kitab." There is no prayer for the one who does not recite Fatihat al-kitab.
Even if you recite the whole Quran.
Even if you recite the whole Quran, it's not going to count. Okay, now I want to give you an example. I want to give you some examples, but I want the newcomers to give me the answer, not those who've been in the class. Okay, I want the newcomers to give me the answers. Let's say you were praying, right? Even, doesn't matter, if you get it wrong, it's okay. We're here to learn. Okay. Let's say you were praying, right? Praying Salat al-Fajr. Salat al-Fajr is how many rak'ah? Two rak'ahs. Very good. All right, in the first rak'ah, you forgot to recite Surah al-Fatiha. Okay? Then when you got to sujood, when you went in sujood, you remember you did not recite Al-Fatiha. Well, how do you fix this?
Do you do sujood like 3 times?
Do you do sujood?
2 times.
2 times? That's it? Okay, that's your answer. Bismillah. No, I'm asking you.
You say Al-Fatiha after?
Where? When? Okay, remember, you are in sujood now. And then you remember. Your brother, he said, you do 2 sajda. When do you do the 2 sajda?
At the
end of the prayer, right? You agree with him? Okay. All right, so you said you have to recite Fatiha. When do you recite Fatiha? Huh? I didn't hear him.
When you are done.
When you're done with the prayer, you recite Fatiha. Are you sure? Brother, don't feel shy. Don't feel, you know, we're here to learn. Everybody here to learn.
It's going to be a guess.
It's okay.
If I realize I forgot to do Fatiha,
which is the pillar, and I am in sujood, how do I fix that?
I think I can recite while I'm still in sujood.
Okay.
Or if I didn't know what I was supposed to do, I will pray again.
Okay. All right. Now I'm going to give you the answer, inshallah. All right. I was praying Salat al-Fajr. In the first rak'ah, I forgot to recite Surah al-Fatiha. Then when I was in sujood, I remembered. All I have to do, go back up. Okay? Go back up. Recite Al-Fatiha again. Because Fatiha is what? It's a pillar. You cannot just skip it. Okay? So you have to actually do it. So you recite it, and you're going to rukun and sujood again. And then, before you salam out, you make 2 sajda, of forgetfulness. Did you get it?
Yes.
Okay? This is the first scenario. The second scenario, you did not realize until you were in the second rak'ah. Okay? Then you remembered, you forgot Al-Fatiha. The first rak'ah is null void, it's gone. Second rak'ah becomes the first. Then you add 1 more rak'ah to finish your Fajr Salat. And you make 2 sajda before you salam out. You got it? Okay. The third scenario. You did not realize until the salat was over. Assalamu alaykum wa rahmatullah. Assalamu alaykum wa rahmatullah. And then you remember. Then in this case, you make up one rak'ah. You make up one rak'ah and two sajda before you salam out. The fourth scenario is when you did not remember until the time was too long. Like for example, Salat al-Fajr and Salat al-Duhr. When you were about to pray Duhr, you remembered. You say, wait a minute. I did not recite al-Fatiha in the first rak'ah of Salat al-Fajr or second rak'ah. So in this case, the scholars, they said, you have to repeat the whole prayer. Are we on the same page? Okay. Now, and like, because I have to repeat this so that the brothers and sisters can get it. Because a lot of time people get confused because they don't really get it down. That's why they get confused. Okay. Now, when it comes to the obligatory acts, and the obligatory acts are how many?
Eight.
Can you mention them? What's the first one?
Transitional
takbirat. Every other takbirah that you do in the prayer, beside the first takbirah, which is what? A pillar.
Takbirat
ihram. We're not talking about the other takbirat. They are from the obligatory act. What else?
Subhana
Rabbi al-Azim, one time in ruku'. Second time and third time is?
Highly
recommend. Sunnah. Okay. What else?
Rising from ruku'.
Sami' Allah liman hamida.
Rabbana
lak al-hamd. What else? No, that's sunnah. Just mention the obligatory act. Go ahead.
Prostration.
Subhana Rabbi al-A'la. One time. What else? The first
tashahud.
And sitting for that? Sitting for that tashahud. And Rabbi Firli between the two sajda. Okay. Now, these are the obligatory acts. Okay. Now, I have a question for you. If you skip any of these eight in the prayer, of course, by way of forgetfulness, right? What do you do here? What do you do? Okay, I'll give you an example. You're praying, and you forgot to say, for example, رَبَّنَا لَكَ الْحَمْدِ. You did not say it. رَبَّنَا لَكَ الْحَمْدِ. Is it from the pillars or obligatory act?
Obligatory
act. Okay, now what do you do like you are in the second rak'ah? Do you lose the first rak'ah or you don't lose the first rak'ah? What happened to the first rak'ah?
If you don't say...
If you forgot to say رَبَّنَا لَكَ الْحَمْدِ.
You still have it.
Okay. What do you say? You agree with him or disagree?
I agree.
Agree? Are you copycatter or just...
I agree.
Okay. What do you say? You agree or disagree?
Agree.
Okay. What do you say? You agree or disagree?
Agree.
I agree. Adam. Don't you're gonna change it?
Yeah.
Wishy washy. You have to be firm. You have to have one opinion based on knowledge, and that's it. You're not gonna budge from that.
I agree.
You agree with him? Yes, your dad is right. Your dad is right. Okay. Now, if you move to the second rak'ah, and you did not catch it in the first rak'ah, you did not remember in the first rak'ah. You don't have to worry about it. All you have to do is what?
To prostration
or forgetfulness.
Before the salam.
Before the salam. Okay? But if you remember Okay? If you remember in the same rak'ah, you could still do it. As long as you have not moved to the second rak'ah. You understand? As long as you have not moved, like for example, the first tashahud, is it from the pillars or the obligatory act? The first tashahud. Huh? Obligatory act. Okay. Now, let's say the imam forgot to sit for the first tashahud. Okay? And the imam, he started raising, going up. Okay, those who are being led by him, what do they have to say in a situation like that? How do they react? They say, Subhanallah. They don't say, hey, you. La. The human speech is not allowed in the salat. Okay? So you say, you say Subhanallah, because Subhanallah is permissible in the salat. Okay, what do women do? They clap their hand. The women clap their hand to alert the imam that there is a mistake. Okay, now if the imam remembered, he has to go back down. As long as he has not stood all the way up and recited al-Fatiha, or the third rak'ah, he can sit back down and do the tashahud. And then at the end of the salat, he makes two sajda before he salams out, and then he salams out.
What if he stood up?
If he stood up, then they stand up with him.
Okay.
They stand up with him. And he makes two sajda before he salams out. Okay, what about if he added a pillar? I'll give you an example. The imam was leading Salat al-Maghrib. Salat al-Maghrib is how many rak'at? Three rak'at. Now the imam, he forgot, and he added a fourth rak'at. Okay? He added a fourth rak'at. Okay, al-musallin, they say Subhanallah. He did not go back down. Because he was convinced it was the third rak'ah. You know, this can happen. This can happen. Okay, in this situation like this, do they follow him or they sit?
They
follow him?
They follow
him.
They follow
him. It's a must. And, okay, now we have two opinions. Okay, I'm going to go to the right. Do they follow him?
They follow the imam.
They follow the imam, even though he's wrong. They still follow him.
Yeah.
And they know that rak'ah is not supposed to be there. They still follow him.
Yeah.
Okay. All right. What you say? Do they follow him? Yeah, they follow him. They follow him.
Definitely follow the imam.
They follow the imam.
Yes.
Brother Azmat?
They should follow
the imam. The brother?
Follow the imam.
I see a lot, majority are saying that they follow the imam. They follow the imam, you're copycatter.
No.
Yes, you are.
I say.
No, they don't. Adam.
They follow the imam.
They follow the imam. Blind follower. You?
I actually have a hadith.
Okay. Yeah, you have the hadith. Okay.
They sit down.
They sit down. It means they don't follow him.
Yeah.
Okay. Brother, they follow him.
Al-Qaeda and you follow him. Yeah.
Those who say you follow him are incorrect. I'm sorry to tell you that. Okay, the reason Adam is, he's referring to the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, innama ju'ila al-imamu li'utamma bihi. The imam is there to be followed, right? Is this the hadith that you're referring to? But we have another hadith. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Man amila amalan laysa alayhi amruna fa huwa radd." Whoever does an action that is not in compliance with a sharia, it will be what?
Rejected.
But which one?
Because this is not
which one overcome the other hadith. I mean,
this, because now the salat is not in accordance to what Allah legislated, because salat al-maghrib is how many rak'at?
Three.
And we know that this imam have added a rak'ah, Even though for him, he is convinced that it is the third rak'ah. But for us, we know for sure that it is the fourth rak'ah. Do we follow him or we don't follow him? Because if we follow him, then we will pray Maghrib how many rak'ah? Four rak'ah.
But you can fix it, right?
No. What you do, the way you fix it, you sit.
The imam, if he can fix it after he knows.
Yes,
he realizes.
But we sit down. Because his situation is different than us. Because we know for sure we pray three.
Okay, my question is, okay, we don't follow him.
We don't follow him. We sit back down.
You sit back and he's up, right?
Yes.
You do your salamat, your own salamat?
No, we wait for him. You wait for him to salam out, and then we salam out. That's it.
So you were the whole time like, okay.
Yes.
Okay.
Naam.
Okay. I present a counter argument. So there is a hadith when the Prophet like he prayed like two rak'ah.
Yes.
Four, right? But the Sahabi, they followed him.
Yes.
Despite they knew that it is going to be like four rak'ah.
Yeah, I think I heard about that.
Yeah, but Sheikh bin Baz, rahimahullah.
Yeah.
He has a fatwa about this. Sheikh Al-Allama Abdul Aziz ibn Abdullah bin Baz, he has a fatwa about this, that you don't follow the imam if you know. Because in that case, they did not know. But if you know that the imam has added the rak'ah, it's not supposed to be there, you don't follow him.
But the Sahaba knew that was four rak'ah because that's what they asked after the prayer.
No.
Did they ask whether
he said, listen, I know the hadith. This, he said to the Prophet, because what happened, you have to understand the situation. Every situation is different. The Sahaba, radhiyallahu alayhim, sometimes when the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is sleeping, they don't wake him up. Why? Why they don't wake him up? Why? No. If the Prophet ﷺ was sleeping, they don't wake him up. Why? Why they don't wake him up?
I don't know.
Okay. Anybody knows? I'm gonna come to that. They don't wake him up because there is a possibility that that Allah is revealing to him. Do you understand? And that's why one time he was sleeping, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and he woke up smiling from his sleep. So the companion said, "Oh, Messenger of Allah, why are you smiling?" Then he said, "I saw my ummah going fi sabilillah, you know." And then he went to sleep, and then he woke up again, and he's smiling. Okay, the reason I'm mentioning this because the companions of the one Allah alayhim, the one who asked the Prophet ﷺ. He said, O Messenger of Allah, was the salat shortened? You understand? Shortened. Because he thought Allah revealed to him that the salat was shortened from four to two. You understand? That's why they followed him. You understand? So it's different. But now we know that this imam, he added one rak'ah. It's not supposed to be there.
It makes sense.
Now it makes sense, right? Yes.
So,
that's why you need scholars. We cannot just read from the books and try to understand it ourselves. You need senior scholars to explain the hadith to us. Because there are certain circumstances. Because the Sahabi, he said, was the salat shortened, O Messenger of Allah? You understand? And then he said after that, okay, if you finish the hadith, he said, I forget like any one of you. You understand? He said that, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He said, I forget like any one of you. When I forget, remind me. You see? Remind me.
I'm just curious. Right?
Yes.
I'm not here.
I understand. Fadal.
Is Sheikh al-Mubaz, which is like a mountain, you know, is it fatwa? It's by Ijma' ulama kull?
There are majority.
Now,
I understand.
The logic, the al-qaida, you gotta follow the imam no matter what.
Yes.
He's responsible for everything.
But you don't follow him in this particular situation.
Okay.
Because you know.
So my question is,
because now, if you know you have prayed three, can you pray the fourth?
No, because
if you pray the fourth, you nullify your prayer.
Huh? Because, like Imam said,
between both is this one is that you know.
You know. If you did not know, it would be a different story. You understand? Because now they said subhanallah, but he still went going. He kept going. You understand? So in this case, you don't go beyond the Sharia. You understand? Because Allah legislated for us 3 rak'at salat al-maghrib. But if you did not know, that would be a different story. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to grant us all al-ilm al-nafi' wal-amal salih. Alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen wa sallallahu wa sallam ala Muhammadin wa alihi wa sahbihi wa sallim. InshaAllah, time for the adhan and the salat. Barakallahu.